I hope more people will come because there's a clash with the big session on Asma Jahangir. So I'm not surprised that most people have gone there. Today we are gathered here to celebrate this great man who was once very well known in Punjab, Ruchi Ram Sahni. He was extraordinary in the sense that he was born away from Lahore in Dera Ismail Khan, a trading family, and he had many parts. He was athletic, he was a mountaineer, he left behind a memoir which is worth reading, and I think there are more books that his great-granddaughter who's here, Neera Burra, who will probably undertake more books. But she's put together this book that we are going to talk about. There is Neera Burra, who's with us, who has done research on child labor, published her books on the situation of child labor in India. She has contributed a very interesting introduction to this memoir of Ruchi Ram Sahni. The other person who's with us to speak is Sajida Vandal, who's been her friend during the time she was here researching this book. Sajida Vandal is the founder of a society of art, and she's very well known in Lahore because she was the principal of Lahore, National College of Arts in Lahore. She's an author of another architect of Lahore that we can talk about. And then there's Dr. Khalid Aftab, who was a long time the principal and vice chancellor of Government College and Government College University. Why he's here is because during his long tenure, he was interested in remembering what we are taught to forget. The association of people who went away from Government College Lahore to India. And he was very keen to bring them back to recall the times that were spent together to create this great tradition of Government College Lahore, the Ravian spirit. I think his remarks will be very important for us here. I would invite Neera Burra to tell us what this venture is all about and how she came to it.
Thank you, Khalid Sahib. For me, this is really a labor of love. My family all came from Lahore, but I grew up, I was born after partition, but I only heard about Lahore. We grew up in Delhi, and the only memories, the only things that we were told was about how absolutely wonderful Lahore was. You know, my mother would talk about cycling to school and cycling to college and the Mall Road and going for tea to Falletti's with her mother and grand aunts, and they all lived in this huge big compound right next to Bradla Hall on 22 Rattigan Road. But you know, as often happens with children, you keep hearing the same story about how wonderful Lahore was. We got really fed up. So you heard from one ear and it came out from the other. So it was many years later that my mother was still talking about Lahore, even though it was now 40, 50 years after, as if it was just yesterday. And she used to talk about her grandfather, Ruchi Ram Sahani, who, because they all lived in the same compound, and Ruchi Ram Sahani, it seemed, wanted to tell his grandchildren about what growing up in Punjab was, because he belonged to a very wealthy family in Dera Ismail Khan. And then four of their ships capsized in the Indus, and the British battalion left suddenly and they all, a lot of soldiers owed money, and they became paupers. So overnight, from riches, they were down to rags, and one day, you know, they had to auction everything, and Ruchi Ram Sahni, who was called Ruchi Ram at that time, had to take off his silk kurta and dhoti and get into khaddar or latha and remove his gold balis and things, and he was very upset. He was all of 5 or 6. So he goes to his father one day and he said, "When will I get my gold balis again?" And the father says, laughs and says, "Badli aayi hai badli, basle basle basle, saade leere hi gille karega hor ki." Meaning the storm clouds have come and it's raining, but they can only wet our clothes, cannot dampen our spirit. And it was a sort of a message in some ways to his children and grandchildren that, you know, you don't give up if there's adversity. And it was very important for my mother because her family had decided to stay back in Lahore. And on the 13th of August, her father was killed just in front of the house, in front of them. And that whole struggle post-partition was, what kept her going was these, you know, what Lalaji, as Ruchi Ram Sahni was called, used to talk about. You don't give up, you fight back, you have to have courage to move on. So this is actually what Mummy used to talk about, and then by accident, through a cousin of hers, and I documented this in the book, this is what the book looks like, I found that he had written an autobiography where he describes his whole journey and things. But, you know, it was written in the 1940s. It was a bad photocopy. I couldn't see, read much of it. So then the journey began of looking for Ruchi Ram Sahni, which also including coming, looking for his papers, looking for where did he live, and that's what brought me to Lahore.
Out of the two principals that we have here, I'd ask Sajida Vandal to tell us how she got to know Neera, and what happened, and what is this all about, Rattigan Road, and you know, your connection with Neera.
Well, I was I got to know Neera through a mutual friend of ours, so sitting here in the audience, Mariam Mehdi. And Mariam said, "Look, my friend has found this autobiography of her great-grandfather, Ruchi Ram Sahni. And she wants to come and, you know, kind of find out about what his life was like at the time that he was here and the kind of places that he's mentioned in his autobiography." The first thought that I had was, look, she's found the autobiography. Why would she want to come and now see those places? And that is what actually drew me to her. People do find autobiographies. They find writings of their ancestors and all. But normally they just go and have it published and that's the end of it. But here was somebody who wants to investigate. She wants to look at it. She wants to really understand the times. Now, this happened to also correspond with the kind of interest that you know, I had, and my husband and I was again sitting in the audience. We had earlier also gone through, you know, looking at a person who was there at that same time, which was Bhai Ram Singh. So that is how, you know, I said, okay, fine. Now, how do we go from here? So she sent me something on the internet, and it was a typed version of that book that she'd found. And there were huge parts of it which were missing, so there were these asterisk marks and all. It was obvious that perhaps the writing was not clear and they were unable to type that. I started, this was frankly the first time I heard of Ruchi Ram Sahni. So I thought, okay, let me find out. And the manuscript that I saw mentioned that he was at the government college, and I rang up, Dr. Khalid Aftab, and I asked him, have you heard of this gentleman? She says, of course. We know him very well. He was in Lahore, you know, we have a declamation, competition in his name. So then I started finding out from other people also, okay, had they heard of this man? And soon enough, I kind of realized that he was known here and yet very unknown. So that's how Neera came into our lives. She came here, she wanted to see the house. I think that was another saga, and I must compliment Neera the way she has investigated for this book. She mentioned herself, so many interesting and charming aspects of that time. And I think to me it looks like a book which is actually two books in one, because there is her investigations also, that she's the author, of course, Ruchi Ram Sahni, had sketched for you a very interesting period, but she brought further life into it. She made it real for many of us. So that's my relationship with Neera. And I might like to add here one little bit of thing. We were in Bhera the day before, and Neera is on to her second book, which is the generation earlier to Ruchi Ram Sahni, and I hope that book also comes about.
I would like Dr. Khalid Aftab to talk about what he has told us in his very nicely written book, Against All Odds, which is his account of what happened to the Government College Lahore for the long time when he was his principal, and then when it became a university, he was the vice chancellor. I think what is interesting to note here is that as a nation, we have two processes. One is the process of forgetting, and the other is the process of remembering. Officially, when we write the history of partition, there is a lot of remembering, and that remembering consolidates our nationalism, and most of it is quite unpleasant. But the thing that we forget were perhaps more meaningful. I would like Dr. Khalid Aftab to tell us how he reached back to that area of forgetting when he was the Vice Chancellor of Government College University.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to congratulate Neera Burra for bringing out an excellent book, which I've enjoyed reading. And the question that Khalid has raised, obviously, is very important. But first, please allow me to say one or two words about Ruchi Ram Sahni as I see him now after reading this book. Of course, we had known him as young students because a declamation was regularly held in the Punjab University called Ruchi Ram Sahni Declamation. And we as young students who were living across the road in Government College used to go there. And it was a big event. Anyone who won the declamation was taken as the best speaker. In 1964, the year of centenary of the college, the college brought out a book called A History of Government College. And on page 115 of that book, I have still got my copy with me, it is written that Dr. Muhammad Iqbal took an officiating charge as professor of philosophy. That was the year 1909. Professor Ruchi Ram Sahni, not professor, Rai Bahadur Ruchi Ram Sahni was given this title, and made second professor of chemistry in Government College, Lahore. And there is also a mention that K.R. Keshap, who later became the founder, head of the Department of Botany, also joined Government College as assistant professor. Mr. Keshap is Kamini Kaushal's father. And of course, he was a well-known professor of botany of Government College. So they were all great people. But just imagine, it was year 1909. Iqbal was still a budding philosophy teacher. So was Keshap. But Ruchi Ram Sahni was an established professor of chemistry in Government College, who had already been awarded this title of Rai Bahadur. When I started reading this excellent book, I immediately got into a kind of number of questions that emerged. And I think the one that intrigued me most was that, look here, here was a scientist, a great teacher, an experimentalist, a reformer, a social reformer, man who promoted communal harmony, man who established so many permanent institutions, became a founder member of the group of scientists way back in 1940 in India, and a lot more. How come that a person who comes from South Waziristan, this is where the family lived, became such an independent, progressive, enlightened, and brave man in a colonial country? That is the question that is still intriguing me. And of course, you do find answer to this question if you read this book the way I read it. And I would like to share with you my personal views on this question. I think three things helped him to become what he is known as now, as Ruchi Ram Sahni, Professor Ruchi Ram Sahni. One, his personal qualities. Two, the family background. And number three, his teachers and the books that he read in Government College, Lahore. There is mention of all these things in the memoirs. Let me briefly talk about the family. There was a mention earlier on that, you know, they were from Bhera, but the family lived in Dera Ismail Khan. And then, because of the business problems, they had to shift. I mean, not the family, but Ruchi Ram Sahni had to move and had to come to Lahore. Luckily, he came to Lahore, got admission in a school which was in Dhyan Singh's Haveli. And this is exactly where the Government College was also housed in the beginning. The other important point is that, let's not forget that it was the culture of South Waziristan which puts emphasis on independence, bravery, defiance, and a lot more. And I believe that as a young boy, he too must have learned all these values. The second question, his personal qualities. I think that explains a lot. He was a polyglot. He knew Punjabi, Urdu, Persian, and English. He was a polymath. He was a scientist who could also apply his scientific knowledge in practical fields. He applied his knowledge, solved so many problems, and also helped so many other organizations to solve their problems. For example, the application of science in problem solving of agriculture sector in India of that period. But more than this, he was the man who was extremely tolerant of others, a man who believed in communal harmony, who believed in almost in every good cause. For example, way back in 1920, that was a period of Khilafat movement in India, he surrendered his title of Rai Bahadur in sympathy with the Muslims of India at that time. Mind you, this is not an ordinary thing. There are very few people who would surrender such a title, and that too at that time. I'm sure he would have taken a lot of pressure for having taken this decision. At that time, he was working in Government College Lahore. Not really in Government College Lahore, but obviously he was a part of the government. Just imagine how many qualities this man had. But I think what helped him most, what would have helped him most, in my view, was his stay in Government College Lahore, first as a student and later as a teacher. The students of Government College Lahore know that the motto of the college is courage to know. Immanuel Kant, the brightest philosopher of all time, says this is the best motto of enlightenment, courage to know. And what it says is, what it conveys is, educating others without direction. So it lays down an excellent principle for the teachers that, okay, educate others, that is, educate your students, but don't direct them like the teachers of madrasas do. Give them an opportunity to think for themselves and then take decisions, whatever they wish to do in life. So, now that was the period when Dr. Leitner, who was the founder principal of the college, had already set up this tradition of enlightenment in the college. And he was not the only person around. There were so many others. Keshav Saab says that it was a privilege to be a student of Maulana Muhammad Hussain Azad in his memoirs. And he said, Maulana Muhammad Hussain Azad was a great teacher and a great scholar. So he really enjoyed being his student. He has also word of praise for other professors who had this interest that he agreed with. But he didn't agree with every teacher. There is a mention of about Dr. Stupnagel, the philosopher. He says probably he made a wrong choice for himself. He shouldn't have been in teaching. Stupnagel, by the way, later became the principal of Government College for a while. But at that time, he was a teacher. You know, these small comments and the details that you find written in the book do tell us a lot about Ruchi Ram Sahni, his individuality, his independent thinking, the influence that the teachers had on him, the influence that the books that he read had on him. For example, there's mention of two books published now. One is J.S. Mill's Utilitarianism. The other is, of course, Bentham's, The Theory of Legislation. And he said, as students, they read the book, and he would discuss it then with his friend Datta, you know, the different implications of the theories that J.S. Mill and Bentham had propounded. So that shows that as student too, I mean, he was curious. Of course, every person who has scientific outlook and has scientific curiosity has the ability to look into issues at a deeper level. So all these things put together made him Ruchi Ram Sahni. And he, along with so many others, created the environment that we all loved, created the culture of tolerance. They were all great teachers. They were men of ideas. They were inspiring. They were inspiring not because they were good teachers only, because they were also tolerant. They were tolerant. And it is that culture which had produced so many other prominent people that the college has produced. Now, coming back to the point that Khalid raised, when I was given this responsibility to look after government college as principal way back in 93, we had had a difficult patch earlier on. And we made a number of plans to bring about a change. The change was, so to speak, nothing new. The change was that what we wanted to do now that had been not done for some time in the institution. And what did we want to do? We wanted to bring back the culture of the college that had been there for so long. Let me just share with you, for those who may not know, the government college was established way back in 1864. It's more than 150 years old now. But it was the culture that Ruchi Ram Sahni and his associates and persons like Leitner and others had developed in the institution that we now in the 90s wish to re-establish. And in that connection,
I'll come back to you again.
Okay.
We have some question to ask from Neera.
Fine.
But it was wonderful. I know that I started this theme that you wanted to connect back to the people who were there, and I think it's worth listening to. We have a series of questions. First is that Ruchi Ram was a typical Punjabi, very strong physically. He was a cross-country runner. He was a great mountaineer, but he had a wonderful mind. And I think the climax was when he joined in Germany, the scientists who were doing research on radioactivity. I mean, that's the kind of mind he had. But Khalid mentioned John Stuart Mill, the person who actually founded the idea of liberalism, which is not very well liked these days in India or Pakistan. But the fact is that Ruchi Ram was a deep-seated liberal, and he was attracted to this new faith called Brahmo Samaj. My question to Neera is, has the family absorbed that, or has the family gone away from that idea that Brahmo Samaj actually wanted to inculcate? First, tell us a little bit about Brahmo Samaj, because many people asked Ruchi Ram to abandon it and join Arya Samaj, which was more kind of fundamental Hinduism. Tell us about the faith that he had and what happened to the family later on.
Thanks, Ali. Actually, I think the family itself didn't know that he was a Brahmo Samaji, because you know, a family meaning, say, my mother and her cousins and siblings and all. That was not the generation when you asked your parents or your grandparents about their political and religious beliefs. But when I first read in his autobiography that he was a Brahmo Samaji, and he also wrote that, and he said very openly that he believed that all religions, Islam, Christianity, Sikhism, Hinduism, were all equal, and there was no question of one religion being better than or superior than any other. He was actually ostracized, and he writes about that in his autobiography. Now, none of this actually the family knew anything about, because the family now is, you know, has different views, but I just wanted to take a little time on that, because for me that was the most exciting part of him, because I asked my professors, I said, Brahmo Samaj in Punjab, I mean, you know, we knew that Brahmo Samaj had grown in West Bengal, in Bengal, and it was a very enlightened group of people who believed in this universal secular thing, but in Punjab it was unheard of, and they were, and he was influenced by his high school teacher, S. N. Agnihotri, who initiated him into the Brahmo Samaj creed. And what is very interesting is that he writes in his autobiography about how he was ostracized by upper caste Hindus. So if he went, you know, he would go to Christian functions or you know, Muslim functions or Hindu Arya Samaji functions. They wouldn't serve the prasad after at an Arya Samaj meeting till he and one or two of the Brahmos who would be there would get up. I mean, it was that. I mean, there's a lot of discrimination within Hinduism, you know, between the castes and all that, but the fact that upper caste Hindus would do that to another upper caste Hindu only because he had Muslim and Christian friends. But he writes in his autobiography something that his own mother would not eat in his house. She was a widow and she would not eat in his house, nor she would live with him. And he begged and pleaded with her and he said, look, I will perform, I promise to perform your last rites in as traditional, as orthodox a way as you want, even though I don't believe in orthodox Hinduism. But she refused and she went back to Behra, and that's where she died. She lived with another son, though he was an older one. So, you know, that, I mean, he paid a price. It was not as if he didn't pay a price, but he paid a price of a different type, but he was willing to pay that price to keep his beliefs and to stand by what he felt. I actually asked some of my uncles about their fathers who were his sons. I said, did they believe in Brahmo Samaj or Arya Samaj? Did they go to the Hindu temples in Lahore? Now you see, his own sons he sent abroad to study. They were all in Cambridge and London and various for 10, 15 years. So they didn't actually, so they said, our fathers didn't believe in religion. You know, they were sort of cosmopolitan club going types. They had become very anglicized in many ways. But the wives would take on Hindu festival, take the children to the mandir and, you know, all of that. So they are all, I mean, I think they are all Arya Samajis now in many ways, and most of them don't even know or didn't know till this book came out that their grandfather and great-grandfather was so secular and so, you know, believed in that this. In fact, in the book, I mentioned how he was also in the Punjab Legislative Assembly from 1924 to 1926. And there's something about giving women rights. And he quotes and he says, please look at Islam and look at the rights that Islam gives to women for education, for property and this thing. And there's no good time as now to be progressive. And so, you know, he, as a Hindu, is standing there saying, this is what you need to look at. You need to look at the best things in each religion and use that as a universal religion. So he really did feel very strongly.
Ruchi Ram died in 1948 in Bombay, immediately after the rupture that took place in South Asia between India and Pakistan. But it took a very long time for the Indian government to realize how big this man was. And it was only in 2013 that a postage stamp of India was issued with his portrait on it. Why did it take so long?
Actually, the fact that it even happened was because of the Vice Chancellor of Punjab University, who is trying to do similar things as Professor Aftab, which is, you know, he was saying Ruchi Ram Sahni was one of the first scientists of Punjab, completely unknown. So this was again a real surprise, because when I came to Lahore in 2013, everybody knew, and thanks to Sajida, who would pick up the phone and call up various people, and they said, of course we know Ruchi Ram Sahni. But our side of the border, complete blank. I went to Chandigarh, Patiala, and nobody had ever heard of the man, you know. So in fact, it took me a long time to even publish this book, because it says, who is ever going to read a book about an unknown man? But he was not unknown here, you know. So it's, and also at that time, our Prime Minister was Dr. Manmohan Singh, who also knew about, you know, Ruchi Ram Sahni. So it was, but he had a very famous son, Ruchi Ram, Professor Birbal Sahani, who was also at Government College, but was the first fellow of the Royal Society. So I think his stamp came out earlier. But Ruchi Ram Sahni was completely unknown, and still remains unknown.
Dr. Khalid Aftab, tell us more about when you were seeking this connection which had been lost, and especially going against the state policy of forgetting, and how did you tackle that, and what kind of opposition you faced?
I think we were lucky as an institution that so many of our former students lived in India and are even now living in India. So we had an association called Old Ravians Union, and it was going to be 140th anniversary of the college. The Founders Day, as we call it. The year was 2004. So I suggested to the office bearers of Old Ravians Union that probably the best way to celebrate 140th anniversary of the college would be to invite the former students of the college from India. So we contacted Sardar G.S. Dhillon, who was the president of the Ravians Association in Chandigarh. Dhillon sahab, may God bless his soul, was a phenomenal person, was extraordinary. He was a charming person. He had lived in Lahore as a student, obviously in Government College Lahore, and won't miss any opportunity to visit Lahore. So through him, we established contact with the old Ravians living in New Delhi and in Bombay. Extended invitation to them, not just the old students, but also their spouses. I said, you bring along your wives as well. So as many as 40 families, 42 probably, families came from India. And that included Dr. P.R. Bamba, the former Vice Chancellor of Chandigarh University. Professor Bamba is a renowned mathematician. He was a class fellow of Dr. Salam in Government College Law. And Professor Bamba is a mathematician in his own right. So he and his wife, as a matter of fact, both of them stayed in our house in GOR1. And other families were accommodated in different families. We didn't took them to the hotels then, so that they could feel at home. And that was a great event. And so we had parties and dinners and functions, and they were all very
nice. If you allow me, can I shift to Sajida? Because if you look at Lahore and you look at the buildings and the architecture, it's only Ganga Ram and that other person, Bhai Ram Singh. And Sajida, you wrote a book on Bhai Ram Singh. Tell us about this person and how he affected the landscape in Lahore.
I think just before talking about that, I'd like to also mention that in the book, in his autobiography, Ruchi Ram mentions Bhai Ram Singh. And he had joined the Muir School of Arts for 6 months to do a carpentry course. Now, that was, you know, very interesting because what he writes about Ram Singh and Munshi Sher Muhammad, who was there, and Kipling, you know, the big figures of the Muir School of Arts, that people seem to have forgotten them. And now this book was closed in 1942. And we had always thought that perhaps it was post-partition that people had forgotten Ram Singh. Ram Singh was the first native principal of the Muir School of Art. And he joined as a young man. He had come from a family of carpenters and had learned carpentry and, you know, been taught in the old traditional system of Ustad and Shagird kind of a way. This was precisely also the way Ruchi Ram started his learning career, because he was trained in a business family and he was being taught how to do business. So likewise, Ram Singh is being taught how to be a carpenter, a very good carpenter. And this man got noticed by the deputy commissioner of Amritsar, because he was living there at the time. And the lady commissioner, deputy commissioner, had a piano, and the leg of the piano had broken, and nobody was willing to go and mend it. And there was this young boy of 14 years who was then brought in to do that. So a kind of a background, there's a similarity in the way that they are, but one is from obviously a wealthier family, and this one is a carpenter. So we thought that, okay, people have forgotten him because he wasn't remembered after the partition. While we were investigating and looking at Ram Singh, because the folklore was this, that the Muir School of Arts buildings had been designed by Kipling. And we as architects felt that it couldn't have been possible, because the very intricate brickwork that is the hallmark of his work cannot be done by somebody who does not understand how the construction is, in brick buildings. So that was what we started with. And soon enough, we found that almost the most important buildings on the Mal Road were attributed to him. And we found evidence of that. Obviously, we had to find the right references and all that. So we found that he'd done the Muir School of Arts, he's done the Punjab University Senate Building, as it was called at that time, which is the Punjab University Hall. He won a competition with a very famous engineer architect of the time in India, who was an Englishman, Jacob Swinton, for the HSN College main building, which was 1886. So, and then the work was awarded to him by a jury of, obviously British kind of selectors. And they said that Swinton Jacob will mold his plan according to the design and vision of Ram Singh, right? So, they were asked to collaborate, because they couldn't imagine perhaps giving a building totally to somebody who was a native architect. So there were lots of buildings along the Mall. And if you also visualize the time that we're talking about, between the Government College, Lahore, and the Muir School of Arts, which was constructed somewhere in 1881, so there is all this buildings coming up, and obviously Ram Singh is not just confined to what is happening within the Government College, but he's also looking beyond. The museum was there by that time, and when he joined the Muir School of Arts. And he writes in his book that while I was there, I was very lucky to be taught by Ram Singh, who was the lead teacher in the carpentry class. But what I really learned from him was going with him to the museum and looking at the paintings, and I was able to appreciate the artistic, the artist's vision, as well as being a scientist and all. So that was interesting. our experience, you know, in this book was also that, you know, in those days, the India and Pakistan were not in good terms. We were doing all the research on our side of the border. And then suddenly the borders opened and we were able to go across. And I must say we were helped immensely by the Indian friends on the other side. And we found that nobody had heard of him. You know, nobody had heard of this man who we thought that we in Pakistan had forgotten. They didn't even know that one of his most outstanding works, Khalsa College, which is in Amritsar, they didn't know the architect was Ram Singh. And the way that we kind of located him within Amritsar and where his family was, we found the address in one of the correspondence that was there at the, you know, in our archives. So we went across and located his family, and you know, they were able to, then we went to the Khalsa College and we told them, okay, this is the architect. I'd like to also mention a small incident, because I don't know whether it's the reason, but I mean, we had especially had a portrait done of Ram Singh, and we took it as a gift for the Khalsa College, and we wanted them to place it on the, you know, and you know, in a place of honor in the institution. And then we went a few weeks later and we found that they hadn't done that. And then we asked the principal that, you know, could we have him there in a place of honor, because he's the architect. So they said, well, you know, the problem is he's a Ramgadia. And Ramgadias are basically carpenters. So had he been a Majitia, you know, so he would have been on the wall. But I don't think this is the reason. I think it's just this, that we seem to have been effectively wiping out a memory, you know, which was the time that we had together. And of course, these were native, he's a native architect. In his lifetime, he'd got an OBE, the Order of the British Empire. He had been sent to England. He was the Queen's architect. He'd done the Darbar Hall. Even at the Darbar Hall in Ospen, you know, in the palace there, the curator asked me, who is this Ram Singh? So, you know, we have wiped people out of our memory. And maybe it's because, you know, of the experience at the end of this 47, you know, whatever happened. Maybe that's the reason.
One last question for Neera before we start discussing this session. There are two Jewish gentlemen born in Hungary who had a great role to play in Lahore. One was, of course, Leitner, who founded Govan College Lahore. The other was Oral Stein, who did a lot of travel up in Central Asia and wrote these fantastic books. But both were involved in Government College at the same time with the Oriental College Lahore also. In the book, Sahni comes across as a very modern liberal person, but there is one episode in which he gets into trouble with Oral Stein. Can you tell us what really happened?
You know what? What I again is sort of struck me was he had enough courage. He was a native professor. There were only three or four of them. But he found that the European professors were actually sharing exam papers, question papers before the exams for their favorite students. And he reported this not once, but more than once, that they were giving the answers to their favorite students. And he paid a price for it, because the principal of Government College at that time, Hemi, I think it was, A.S. Hemi, said, how dare you as a native have the courage to say anything about a European or a British professor? And he was superseded as a result. And he says he was really, really upset, because his life was Government College, and not being made the head of department, but having a
much younger, less qualified person being the head of the department really, really upset him. And he, in fact, goes back home and he's walking up and down his house and he says, and he writes this in his book at the end, "Am I a dead fish? Am I a live fish? Can I swim against the tide, or can I, do I have to follow the tide?" And he decides that night that he was going to leave government college, take leave and go to Germany to study radioactivity. So he takes leave of absence and he goes to Germany, and unfortunately to the outbreak of World War I, and he writes right at the end that he escapes from Germany and then goes to Manchester. He doesn't mention that. I found out later from his own writing somewhere else that he works with Ernst, Professor Ernst Rutherford and Niels Bohr. Now, I'm a sociologist. I had no idea who these people were. So when I'm telling my sons this, and they said, "What? You mean your great-grandfather worked with these
Niels Bohr.
Niels Bohr and Ernst Rutherford?" I said, "Who are they?" So I felt really quite foolish, because they said, you know, they are the guys who discovered the molecule, whatever, you know, radioactive. So he was, and he actually planned to come back and work on it, but his plates got damaged and he couldn't continue that research. So, he paid a price at every level, but he was not daunted by any of this. He came back, okay, so he worked with Professor C.V. Raman for a short time, and that also, he doesn't mention in his autobiography, but I did a lot of research in the Tribune, the old Tribune, and I found that C.V. Raman is saying at a function in Government College that I have known Professor Ruchi Ram Sahni much before you people have known. I've known of his work. But he moves away from science and he gets involved in politics, in the Gurdwara reform movement. So he's a Brahmo Samaji on one hand. He's deeply involved in the Gurdwara reform, and he's written a book on the reforms in the Sikh shrines. He's very much a part of the war, what they call the war committee. So he, there's a dhakka here, but you don't stop here, you move somewhere else. And then of course he stops his autobiography in 1914, but he also says somewhere that I got involved for the 10 years in the Dyal Singh Majithia probate case, because Dyal Singh Majithia had an estranged wife. When he died, he left his entire estate to the Brahmo Samaj, to the Dyal Singh College and the Tribune and to other trusts. He left something for his wife and others, but, and so he got involved in that whole process. So, he was parallelly doing various things. There was this whole Dyal Singh Majithia probate case. There was working on this Guru Ka Bagh agitation. He then decides to become a journalist for the Tribune informally, and he walks with the Jathas and sends photographs of the violence perpetuated by the British soldiers against the Akali, the Jathas that were going. So, he has parallelly doing a lot of very interesting things. He's working with the Muslims, he's working with the Sikhs, he's working to reform Hinduism, which is, he was absolutely unsuccessful. And he's writing all this time. And one of the things he mentions in his autobiography, which I just want to quickly mention, is that he says he didn't want to spend more time on his autobiography, because at some point, he sat at the age of about 14, 15, he read a book called The History of Our Own Times, and decided that he was going to write a history of my own times. And there are mentions about the history of my own times in the autobiography, see as references. And of course, everything was left behind in Lahore in 1947. So for me, when my reason for coming to Lahore in 2013, that when I met Sajida for the first time, was, will I be able to find the house? Maybe his books are still there, because so many people said, they've come back and the house is still there and the book, everything is still there, and people are, unfortunately that was not to be, and because of Sajida's perseverance we went on round and round in circles and went upstairs. Then she said, let's go up to the chhat, one of the little shops, and I looked down and there was something that looked like an old building. So we dashed down and it was just a little wall and with two rooms, I think it was, of the old house where they were printing the Quran or something. So, you know, I came to Lahore to look for his other paper, The History of My Own Times, and it was not there. Then when I went back, my son said, go to Chandigarh, maybe they are in the archives there. And I went straight, I took a train, went to Chandigarh, went to the archives, and I asked them there, I said, do you have any papers by Ruchi Ram Sahni? And they said, Ruchi Ram Sahni? Of course not, but Lala Lajpat Rai, yes, we have the whole library. So I said, is there any room that you have not opened? And they opened a room, I said, just give me a jharan, I will look for it myself. And suddenly somebody said, a homer chomat ki hega? And I said, but that's what I'm looking for. And then she took out these, under the cabinets, there were some volumes of The History of My Own Times. You know, I was shivering and looking at it. And then she says, Unadi Ruth Vanu Love Raisi. His spirit was looking for you. And you know, for a minute I just stopped, because after 70 years, almost 70 years, to have these things lying somewhere, I just felt, and this journey is for me that way very special, because I just feel that somewhere he's coming back and saying, go here, you may find something. Because in his letters to his sons, he says, please publish my books, because I spent half a century writing them and I don't want them to be lost. So this is actually a very personal journey for me.
Thank you very much, Neera. I'm told we have run out of time. I'm so sorry. Otherwise, we would have asked some questions. Thank you. Thank you very much.